All right, Joseph Conrad, who we're taking a look at here. I got a map of the world, because he goes a lot of places. And if you did not know, there are sea monsters in the Atlantic. Right there. Anybody in here have like a double middle name?
What is that?
Like, what's your middle name?
Oh.
So, what's your middle name?
This is Ryan.
Ryan, so Brady Ryan Smith. Yes. So you're not like Brady Ryan Michael Smith. Or sometimes you might have like a confirmation name that goes along with it, so you can get all this kind of extra fun stuff in it. Joseph Conrad. It's impressive. He's going 5 on you. So, whereas Brady Smith takes up 8 little boxes, or well, I guess, no, 10 boxes on the SAT, right? Yeah. It's a lot of boxes this guy's taken up. Joseph Theodore Conrad Nalich Korzenowski. Growing up, he goes by Conrad, so he just takes like the middle one, and that's what he goes with. His tombstone, they misspelled his last name. For everyone to see. The last part, the Korzenowski, I forget what they do. I can't remember what the letters are, the how it gets messed up, but they go with his full name and, oh well, what are you going to do? My tombstone's going to say everything was beautiful and nothing hurt. It's all. I'm not going to put dates on it or anything, just have that. Might. Yeah, that's a popular turtle. Birth date is 1857, December 3rd. So this is 5 years before Cyrus joins the Union Army, if you're going to, like, you know, mix fact and fiction together. He's born in the Ukraine, which is formerly at that time part of Poland, but that part is also controlled by Russia. So he would consider himself Polish, but he is a Russian citizen. Kind of under protest. His parents, Apollo and Eva, both of their families are educated landowners who are very interested in Polish independence. Grandfather is part of an uprising in 1830, military uprising, fight, and all that kind of stuff that ends up proving unsuccessful in the long term. So his family is one that continues to push for independence. It's not that his family are hiring mercenaries and attacking czars or anything like that, that there are, you know, agents coming after to assassinate them. But they are certainly fighting for political independence. They're kind of doing a lot of the legwork for it, more of the philosophical arguments for independence and all those things. Conrad, as he grows up, he ends up leaving everything, which we'll get into the issues why. I don't think he needs to feel bad for leaving family and stuff like that. But it is something that kind of eats at him a little bit personally, because the family has always been, you know, fighting for independence, and it's something that he doesn't really kind of partake in to the extent that grandfathers and uncles and grandmothers and mothers and all that kind of stuff have. His family does get exiled to Vologda in 1862, so he's young at this point. He's only 4, going on 5 when the family ends up being exiled. They are exiled in the sense that they are removed from support network, friends, family, and things like that. They are not going to labor camps. They are not going into, you know, like prisons and all that kind of stuff. But they are being removed. And they do kind of get shuffled around a few times. And they actually end up getting relocated to some better conditions later on. But where he is born over here, you're taking a look at Russia, Soviet, and this is more of a modern map. Moscow would be about here. He's north about 300 miles. So he's pretty far up there. He's not in Siberia, you know, in the middle of nowhere, but it's certainly a remote place that he is. While the family is in exile is when his mother dies, and then 4 years later his father dies. Both of them die from tuberculosis. So it is more natural causes. It's not that, you know, their tea was spiked, Kathy didn't put something in it, and then they keeled over or anything along those. Assassinations and plots and all that. So how old would he be in 1869? He'd be be 11 going on 12. So it's 11 is when his father dies. At that point, he would be an orphan. Okay. And so he goes to live with an uncle. That uncle's in Poland, in Krakow. Lives with his uncle. His uncle does like formal education, you know, hiring tutor and all those kinds of things. It's not something that Conrad's really all that into. He does like literature, really specifically poetry, and he is learning languages. One of the languages that he learns is French at this point. So he's trilingual now. He knows Polish, he knows Russian, and he also knows French. He decides that he wants to be a little bit more hands-on in the world. So 1874, he decides to be a merchant marine for France. Anyone want to know what a merchant marine is? Definitely more trade than military. So you still work for the French government. You're still a naval officer for the French government, and France and Great Britain really would be the two big, you know, naval forces at this point. You're still an officer, but you're not doing combat. You're not going to go attack people. You might escort some things. More traveling so far as trade, commerce, things like that. I'm sure there probably would be some Coast Guard type duties, but as opposed to just kind of being around France, you're going to be going a little bit all over the world. But he's always kind of had a call for the water, for a sea life. And based on, you know, where he's at, you don't really have a whole lot of opportunities because there's not a ton of trade that's going to be going on right up here north of him. He wants to get more out into the oceans. And so that's where France, Great Britain are going to offer those opportunities for him. 1874, how old would he be? Math, this is tough. Yeah. How old are you? What have you done with your life?
Not that much.
Not that much. I mean, this guy's out there checking everything out. So starting in when he is 16, 17, and he's not a captain of a ship or anything like that. He's going to be a deckhand, kind of working his way. Places that he is going, the West Indies he goes to many times, three times. He ends up being a gun runner and a smuggler for the Spanish faction, the Carlists, during the Spanish Civil War, kind of making a little bit of money on the side, but he's not sitting in AP English fourth period taking notes. So he's happy. I don't know if you're happy. Okay, she's okay. He runs into a little bit of a problem, though, because France goes, you know what? You need to be a French citizen if you're going to be a Marine for us. There's too much political issues taking place. You're a citizen of where? Not Poland. Diana, he's Russian. He considers himself Polish, but he's part of the Russian Empire. And they're like, that's not going to work, so you need to find something. So he kind of gets his pink slip, and that's that for him. Asia, you're on low battery. Okay. Give the iPad some coffee. Look at all these happy screens, and then Madison and Paige offline. So what he does in 1878, hey, I'll join the English Merchant Marines. They know that he is not English. They know that his citizenship is Russian. And they go, that's okay. Come along anyway. Because they have a big span that they are trying to cover so far as oceans and seas. And they need a lot of people. His one issue, well, I don't know one issue, but definite an issue or an obstacle for him would be he knows very little English. Now, he can still get by based on things that he picks up. And honestly, his French skills probably would come in best for him because that would be a fairly common language that he would be interacting with. But 1878, he's now an English merchant marine, knowing very little English, and now he's going to bounce all over the place. I'm going to show you places that he goes. You don't have to like write them all down to keep up with where he has been. So places of his would include... He is going to Australia, which is going to be part of the British Empire, so it kind of makes sense at that point. He's going to South America. Again, a lot of this is going to be with trade and whatnot. India is a place that he goes to. Borneo, South Pacific, so he's certainly bouncing all around. Notice he stays away from the sea monsters in the northern Atlantic, because all good ship people know to avoid that. Douglas, did you not see the map? Like, right there. I mean, that thing's the size of Florida, Texas, Alaska. You know, you're avoiding that thing at all costs. That's why I'd go to the South Pacific. 1886, big year for him. His name is now Joseph Conrad. He is a British subject. Also, professionally for him, he is now a captain of his own vessel, which is pretty significant that in an 8-year period, you went from joining the English merchant marines, the British, not really knowing a whole lot of English to begin with, and 8 years later, you're captain of the vessel. So he's kind of gotten his sea legs. He's proven his worth. He is a British subject, so certainly the expectation, the loyalty is there. And when he does retire in 1894 from this life, he settles in England. So even though he is Polish, if you were to, like, you know, who is Joseph Conrad, I would assume Wikipedia would go, he's a British author, because he is always just kind of considered to be British. Brian, do you know my least favorite author of all time? No. No. T.S. Eliot. You know T.S. Eliot? He's a British poet. Born in St. Louis. What's up with that? We're not good enough?
Can't stand that guy. Thomas Stearns Eliot.
I don't like his writing, yeah. I don't know. I made that decision 20 years ago, and I'm, like, sticking to it, you know, at this point. One of the places we did not mention so far as his travels purposely is he goes to Africa, continent, specifically Congo. And I'm assuming last year probably picked up some things about Congo so far as imperialism, slave trade, minerals, and resources, and all that kind of stuff. Belgium has a strong foothold within the Congo, in the continent of Africa. 1890, he's contracted for King Leopold II to do some things for the Belgian colonial service. So he does that in 1890. It's a fairly short-lived mission, and there are certainly some murky details as to what exactly was his mission. But the main thing that brings it to an end is he does contract malaria while he's in the Congo. It does not kill him, you know, at the time or anything like that, but he ends up dealing with some lifelong health effects with it. If you were to take a look at a map of Africa right here, dead center, that is the Congo. Okay, so it is coastal, and that you can get it from the western side, but it's pretty much dead center of the middle of the continent. It is in the center of the continent. It is in the heart of the continent. Africa at this time, especially from imperialistic powers, refer to it as the dark continent. So there is definitely some symbolism going on, I'd say dual symbolism going on with the title, Heart of Darkness. You're in the heart of Africa. It takes place in the Congo, although he never really says that. But there's also a big psychological aspect to it. So you're looking at the darkness of the heart, the darkness of the soul, you know, so to speak, within a lot of people. The Congo is a rich area so far as resources. There's two big resources that are getting pulled out of the Congo. One is industrial, one is luxurious. Any ideas? One of them?
Rubber
is the industrial one. Took Daniel's answer away. Any idea on the luxurious one? It's not diamonds. Not rubies. There might be some there, but the big one, same color, ivory. Ivory, tusks. So like piano keys, jewelry, things like that, there's a lot of ivory. And that's going to be the main item that gets mentioned in here. I think a lot
lot of that is for some figurative effects and some contrast, because you're dealing with the heart of darkness, yet we're taking out that white, pure, you know, innocent kind of material from it. So Conrad's going to kind of play around with that a little bit.
River-wise, you know, you have the Nile running north and south, longest river in the world. You know what river's flowing through the Congo?
The Congo River. I don't know where it ranks so far as mileage, you know, distance. It'd be top 10, but it is number 2 in the world behind the Amazon in volume of water. So while it's not as long as the Nile, it's very wide, it's very deep, it's very treacherous. And it kind of winds around like a snake. So it's not an easy thing to ride across. So taking a trip into the Congo is definitely not an easy thing to do. 1894 is when he permanently retires and decides to settle in England. He has been collecting information. He's been writing things. He's been doing poetry, journals, notebooks, kind of the beginnings of stories. And almost right off the bat, 1895, he publishes his first novel. A lot of his books tend to deal, or a lot of his texts tend to deal with water, sailing. And a lot of his characters certainly come from, or inspired by, people he met, circumstances that he experienced, Heart of Darkness being no different, as it's about a ship captain that is going for the first time, you know, into the Congo, working for Belgium. Like Dickens, he publishes most of his things in magazines and periodicals. So Heart of Darkness has three parts. It has three parts because it got published over the course of 3 months. And so each one would be of pretty much equal length because it would get equal space print, you know, within the magazines. And as mentioned, drawing from his experiences within the Congo in 1890, and then Conrad ultimately dies after a fairly long writing career on August 3rd, 1924. So every August, I celebrate my wedding anniversary, and then we post Joseph on that. Did they get cards for each other this year? Did they get, like, happy anniversary card? Did you get them an anniversary card? Mrs. King got me an anniversary card. No, she didn't get it to me. She forgot. So, like, that puts me in an awkward predicament. What do I do? Do I show you up and, hey, here's your card? Or do I just, like,
well,
oh, that's okay.
The
that's the same
thing. Then it's like, oh, why did you get it? She still got me one, but, like, I just kind of thought about it. Doesn't make it any better, but she's still...
I'm just saving it for next year.
You guys actually save it?
I do. She talks about Pythagoras. I talk... Aw, no iPad for you. The next slide is basically going to say the same thing that you wrote down a little bit ago, so you're not going to have to worry about that one. Good? Matt, are you good? You got a friend in Abby?
I got it.
Okay, good deal. Pretty much already told you, you know, this stuff about him captaining the ship, going down into the Congo and whatnot. One of the things that you might struggle with or find kind of annoying is he is very vague with his information within the book. You're not going to be seeing the term Congo come up over and over again, or you're not going to see Belgium coming up over and over again. So it can be a little difficult to follow who he's with, where we're at. That's the fun of it. But we'll get into that. Ryan, he has a really good tie knot. When you see a picture of Conrad, he looks good. That's why I like him.
Thank you.
Grace, can you tell what it says above the door? Yeah. No, not that one. Sorry.
Oh.
In the red.
The horror.
There you go. So, as you walk out, Dylan, high five the horror. Things will be good.
Did you make that yourself?
Yeah. If you're a movie person, Apocalypse Now, with Francis Ford Coppola, is basically Heart of Darkness, but he changes it to Vietnam. So don't watch the movie, though, I just read Heart of Darkness, but it's been certainly used before. Compared to East of Eden, a lot fewer characters. There's really only going to be two names, actually three, but two main ones. You're going to have Marlo and Kurtz. Marlo, you're going to know right off the bat. Kurtz, you're going to wonder, when in the world will this guy ever show up? He will, but it takes a little while. But what he does is he ends up using groupthink, or you could even kind of argue it's almost like stereotypes, where he'll take something, oops, didn't mean to do that, like the lawyer, the manager, the accountant, the manager's uncle, the station manager, and he'll the intended for a fiance, and use those as characters as opposed to names. There's a couple different theories as to why. I think one of them is he's writing about imperialism in 1899. Imperialism is still, unfortunately, going strong. So I don't think he wants to include a whole lot of details about the people he comes across, and he keeps it kind of generic. So, you know, instead of going Daniel, I could just go the student. And he knows, and I know, that maybe I'm talking about him, but if I just keep it at the student, you know, I've kind of kept things a little vague and ambiguous. He also does a lot of primitivism. And what we mean during this about this is some of the terminology that he uses, as well as saying things like the lawyer, the manager. When it comes to the indigenous people of the Congo, he'll write the brutes, the savages, the cannibals. It's not positive terminology. It's not good diction. He really comes under attack, you know, 50 years later after he dies, by Nigerian writer Chinua Achebe in the 1970s, where he basically goes, this book should not be taught, shouldn't be considered as part of great literature in the English canon, because he dehumanizes too many Africans. And he's right. He has a point about it. So one of the things we'll kind of take a look at is, why does he write it the way that he does? And I don't want to fall into that blanket statement of, well, it's a product of the times, because I think that ends up kind of getting utilized too much. But how and why does he portray people in the way that he does, and what is that overall message that he's trying to get across? But he certainly has been there. He has seen some things. With the Congo, you're looking at like 6 to 10 million lives lost while Belgium's in there. So he has a lot of material